Peace of Christ be with you. Well, it's going to be a different worship service today. I have not printed out my sermon for today. But
4 o'clock this morning,
with a very restless Thurston on the bed, needed to go out about 1 o'clock again. So I took him out, silence, no one's out and about. Then about 4 o'clock, I heard voices outside on the street. And you know, I've always said, oh, why can't people, if they're walking at night, talk and whisper like it's the time that it is, not 2 or 3 o'clock, you know, not doing it like it's 2 or 3 o'clock in the afternoon. So I decided to get up and get dressed and be in my office. Usually I'm up about between 5 and 5:30 on Sunday mornings, and heard some commotion outside, and I opened the shade, and the brown house is involved in flames. And from around the chimney, 15, 16-foot flames on the roof. You could see that's in the back of the house, and they were involved in flames. So I called 911, and the person said, oh, that's just been called in. And I understand that somehow after that call, a few people got out of the house involving children. And that, praise be to God for that. Shortly thereafter, the whole entire house was just involved in flames. So I called Lidstone, the person who was doing the worship at Lidstone, and I was doing communion and come over here after that. I said, I'm not going to come. I need to be here. So next week, there's that concert with Dan Shaw. And I'll tell you, people look so forward to that from even, you know, the different churches. And I'm using that opportunity. I've asked Mary Lou with her expertise if she could be covering for me for a call to worship. And the choir will sing before he starts the concert. So I can be with Lidstone and fill them in on what's gone on, and also be with their community of faith, just talking about this last weekend. I wasn't with you, for I was at a seminar on anti-racism training. I'm telling you all this to set your minds in a certain space. So far, the 9 or 10 people that I've talked to about it, of the many people I've talked to about this house across the street, first things they said, good, good. Or they've said, they've asked, has the fire been set? One, I don't know. And two, at this point in time, I don't care. So I just want to set the record straight, okay? If we worship God and believe that the Lord only wants the best for us, we can pray for the people displaced by what's happened in that house. And I talked with the owner of that house, you know, and people were concerned about the dogs. Are the dogs okay? So I haven't seen Q-Ball or Lucky, Q-Ball being the first dog that I met when we were here. And he's in shock. John was standing there in shock. And he's looking at me. He says, they could stop the fire. If they wanted to stop the fire, they could stop the fire. And as I'm looking past him into the house, the fire is fully involved in this house. It's got so much water, it doesn't seem to make a difference. So a determination was made by the fire department that they would fill that. Special things were done to allow them to use a larger hose from up the street to be able to fill that basement with like over 700 gallons of water. And then the plans were to raise the building, because you could see it. As they were putting more water on the fire, it would stop there, start over there somewhere, and then start again where they were. They couldn't seem to keep it from igniting. So if they could raise the building, it would go into the basement, and they can keep it somewhat contained. So there's a knock on the door, and someone said early on, they said, why don't you pack a couple of bags, overnight bags, in case. Because when water hits that flame, it's going to cause sparks, things like this, and it may light on our roof, which is asphalt. Okay, saints, I'll tell you, there's nothing more eye-opening than the stories that you hear on television and the news, all these fires that have been around, and most recently in Hawaii, or Maui, to go get your things because you're going to have to evacuate your building. How can you even do that? I mean, it took me 20 minutes alone just to be able to find all the things and asking, do I want to save this? Do I have to save this or whatever? It's a decision no one should have to make, okay? But what I need to say is that this man who owns the house is shaking, and he's saying, I don't know what we're going to do. And he's saying, at least the dogs are fine. He said when he was awoken, however that happened, and he was able to get out, he realized that one person who was sleeping there last night wasn't around. He went into that person's room, fallen dead asleep on a mattress that each corner of the mattress had flames coming from it. And he was in the process of being burned. So the owner grabbed the person by the hair and just dragged him out to safety. Praise be to God. Okay? So saints, I want your minds to be on today. The scripture is about carrying your cross and following Christ. We're in a position, saints, the churches all over the world, with this situation that's happening all over the world, the homeless and whatever, we don't know how to deal with it. Because we don't have the physical means to help people, and our hearts are sick about it. And the people who are on drugs and addicted, we don't know what to do about it. Seeing people walking the streets or homeless, we don't know what to do about it. But I'll tell you what a bishop told me a long time ago, that the most powerful thing we can do is to pray. Saints, there's a lot of power in prayer. There really is. So if you, in your moments, be thinking about this building. I told someone this morning from the church, we were standing there looking at what was going on, and it said, in many ways, it's a blessing. But in many ways, it's also a trial for the people who are now displaced. Okay? And now they have to wait for the rubble to cool so they could look for bodies. So just in just a few hours, what we've witnessed rather remotely, and we could say, whew, thank God it doesn't affect us because they're halfway around the world. In many ways, it's affecting us today because it's affecting people in our community today, and it'll affect them tomorrow. So let's hold them up in prayer. Let's just have a moment of silence for this building, for the people who are displaced and the owner and that family that's left behind and those people that they have yet to find. Lord, let thy will be done. And may you be able to care for your children in any way, shape, or form that you deem necessary. Lord, we ask all this in your holy, precious name. Amen. Amen. Thank you.
I don't read everything quite right. My reading glasses are home. Good place for them. Followers of Christ, God calls us just as we are to live as truth tellers and gospel bringers to in the world.
God, we know you call us, and still we ask.
Who am I that you should call me?
Like Moses standing before the burning bush, convinced of his unworthiness to lead your people out of bondage, we ask.
Who am I that you would call me?
Like Peter, who thought he got it right only to realize that who Jesus is doesn't meet his expectations of what a Savior should be, we ask.
Who am I that you would call me?
As we raise the question to God today, we open our hearts to receive God's answer.
You are my disciples.
You are my people, called to share the love of God for the transformation of the world. Amen. Let's remain standing for our opening prayer. Let's do this in unison. Lord of all power and might, the offer and giver of all good things, graft in our hearts the love of your name. Increase in us true religion, nourish us with all goodness, and bring forth in us the fruit of good works. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. Please stand and sing opening hymn 454, Open My Eyes That I May See. Please be seated. Before we do the mystery box, there's some announcements I've got to get out of the way and inform you of. In the bulletin insert is a six-week membership class that I'm starting Tuesday, September 5th. And it's going to be going from 10:30 in the morning, for about an hour. And if together we say it should be longer, it'll be an hour and a half. That's happening in the morning, and it's happening in the evening at 6:30. Let me know. Right now, the majority of people who want to take that are members. And it's good to listen again and familiarize ourselves with what it means to be United Methodist. We're going to be discussing what other denominations, what other religions believe, so that we better see where we fit in the midst of all those other religions. We're going to have some videos in this series, the latest ones from the conference as to the Global Methodist Church and the New England Conference, and what those differences are and what the theology is behind them. And there hasn't been a lot released on that up to this point, so we'll talk about that. But it is not a gathering completely focusing on what the rift is that's happening between the denominations. That's part and parcel of how that affects who we are as members. And that's the reason for this class. It'll be a lot of fun, I promise you. We won't be playing board games, but we will be just talking about how what's happening in the church and churches today are affecting us in worship, our theology with God, and vice versa. And it's held in such a way that if you can only make it 2 or 3 weeks, you'll get something out of it. So if you start and you have to leave and come back, that is fine. So if you can make it, the first one is on Tuesday. And just let me know. There's a form here you could fill out. You can also contact me by way of email and just leave what your preferences are. Okay, that would be great. Let me see. Dan Shaw, as I mentioned, will be here on the 10th. And we will have a beginning worship service, and it'll go right into his concert. Okay? Now, we will have two Saturdays in September, the 9th and the 16th, where we will offer a free will offering breakfast from 8 a.m. to 10 a.m., like we did last year. The menu will vary each week, so please come, bring a friend, enjoy food and fellowship. The NOW team is sponsoring another pie sale and bake sale on Saturday, September 16th, from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m., and are looking for bakers. And you know, the Methodist Church is nothing like their bakers, I'll tell you right now. So please bring your pies and or baked goods to the church either on Friday morning from 9 a.m. to 12 noon, or Saturday morning from 9 a.m. to 10, and you could stop in for our free will offering breakfast while you're at it. The worship committee is seeking volunteers for communion stewards and stewardesses. So if you feel a calling to somehow be involved with worship by way of communion, which, by the way, is one of the most personal sacraments that we do, because we believe Jesus Christ is present in the actual administration of that. So it is a wonderful feeling. And if you could be a steward or stewardess, it's not, Deb, I believe it's like once every other month or something like that, perhaps. I don't know what the actual rotation would be, but that's going to be based upon how many people we get to volunteer. And we're also looking for bread makers. I mean, we've been very successful thus far, interesting recipes, etc. And especially if you have a very tasty gluten alternative, that would be welcome as well. But so if you've got a hankering to bake, please try baking some communion bread for us. And Diane Fitzpatrick is the contact person if you choose to do so, okay? Are there any announcements I did not make that need to be made? Okay. Thank you. Okay, we have the mystery box. Now, Deb started to show me, and I said, whoa, 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 whoa. I don't want to cheat. Today's supposed to be the first day that I will return like we did and be able to talk about it. And she said, oh, I was prepared to talk about it. So I'm going to let her talk about it. Okay.
And then you can add, too.
Well, you need to talk on the mic. Okay.
Well, I can't.
If I may, I'll
yeah.
Okay.
A couple of weeks ago, I was talking to my brother, who doesn't go to church very often, if ever anymore, but he was telling me that he does stuff for the homeless in Lewiston and Auburn. He went out and he bought 20 sleeping bags, and he goes and buys some of the stuff I've got in here as well, like you get at a motel, and he takes those so that they can all have individual bags and stuff. And I said, I know that some of us have some at home, because I remember Lewis Greenier bringing in a bunch, and I brought in some. And now I guess they might need it more than ever across the street. But this was supposed to be on little things and simple things. And the other thing I have is this book about Wesley, and it's called Three Simple Things, Three Simple Rules. And the first rule, thank you. Mm-hmm. I got this at conference, I don't know, quite a while ago. And the first rule is do no harm. The second rule is do good. And the third one is stay in love with God. And those are all pretty simple, that's pretty simply written. Mm-hmm. And I think we need to try and follow those the best we can with all that's happened this morning, and maybe take some of the little things we can over to the people who need them. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And
well, see, I think our first inclination is to see how we on our own can address what we believe to be a problem. And people do that. It's a knee-jerk reaction, especially if faithful people, can you hear me all right? To be able to say, this is what I want to be able to do. And that's wonderful. But the Lord has called us together as the body of Christ. So what needs to happen is to be able to say, this event happened across the street. It's a little too early to tell what the result of it will be. But it's just pray. You have the power to pray at home and here to say, Lord, enlighten me as to what it is I can do as part of this body of Christ. Churches are having a real bad problem thinking that the problem outside there, addiction, homelessness and all that, is too much for the body of Christ to bear. So I'm here to tell you that nothing is too great for our God. Nothing. But God also works through us as God's advocates in the world to be a mirror of Jesus Christ in the world. And it may be whatever we determine individually or as a body of Christ to help these folks, displaced or even the owner who's there, no place now to go. Are we asking for housing? No. But are we asking to be in prayer and take God's lead as to where to go? Yes. I think that is what we need to do as a church. So, you know, and it starts with those three simple things that you can remember. No one's asking for a college exam form. We're asking that your prayers first and foremost go up to God for these people who are displaced, and that when the time comes that we can verify that everyone has gotten out safely from that home. Okay? So thank you. All right, thank you very much. So my question is, boy, that mic's a good mic, isn't it?
Yeah.
Who wants it for next week? Awesome. Okay. Wonderful. Wonderful. All right. We're going to give Cheryl the box.
think I'm still up. The gospel lesson is Matthew 18, 21 to 28.
Matthew 16?
Matthew 16, 21 to 28. Please stand if you're able. And this is Jesus foretelling his death and resurrection. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord. This must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." And the second part is about the cross and self-denial. Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what that has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." This is the word of God for the children of God.
Thanks be to God. Thank you. Please be seated.
Thank you.
Please be seated, I guess. That's all right. My very first wedding, I said, I now pronounce you man and wife. The congregation may be seated. So they stood up for the whole ceremony. So now I always put that in red to make sure I ask people to sit down. Let me ask you, gaining the world but forfeit your life, what sort of things happen in the world that take our interest, not interest, but take our focus on God? What happens in our life that could remove our focus from our Lord? Any ideas?
Fear.
Fear. Okay, anything else?
Money, power.
Money, power. Lack of money or power as well.
War.
Very good. Anything else? What about within your households? What could take you away from focusing on God? Pardon?
Gossiping.
Gossiping, very good. Gossiping. Any other ideas? Oh, TV. Who's got cable? Who's got streaming on their computers? Anybody? Okay. I thought maybe that would help focus, and cable is going away eventually. It's just that the streaming services, everything is based on streaming now. So you pick what you like. If you like cooking and you pay so much a month for the cooking network, or we're kind of, people are telling us how to fine-tune things. But I remember when Karen and I were first married and we got cable, I like to channel surf, and she would channel surf, and she'd say, I have never seen so many stations before, and I've never seen so much junk. So you stop and you go to look at, many of us spin our wheels looking at cable television, and at the end of 2 hours or something like that, what have you accomplished other than watching garbage? Saints, there's just a lot making our lives so complex, and there are things that we need to do. A lot of the planning and the work, the working towards certain goals or whatever, gets limited because so many things are calling upon us as parents, as children, people with responsibility, that takes a priority in our lives and can. So what Christ is saying here is that we can gain all the trappings in the world, we can get involved with the things within the world, but we need to realize that we cannot forfeit your life of being with God in the future. That's what it means by there are people in this world that want to gain all the trappings of the world and be part of the world, and God says you are to be in the world, not of the world. Have you heard that? And the danger of being of the world is that you lose sight of what's necessary to live your life for Christ. Because thank you all to everybody who was able to come to the memorial service yesterday. One of the closing remarks is that Gwen did not leave home. She went home. You see, that's where our home is in heaven. with God and Christ. So we are actually legal aliens in this world, but our goal is to be elsewhere. So I don't have a sermon, considering all the things that have happened this morning. If anyone has a chance to get this book, it's called Grace for the Moment, and I've got an order that's supposed to be coming. And I ordered a short quantity of books, probably eight to ten books, and I waited impatiently for a month and a half for them to come, and the UPS man always rings the bell to let us know. He leaves it on the porch. And this is the package. One book. So I've had to reorder. And it's a daily discipline. And as I opened it, I'm saying, well, I want to read, this is Max Lucado, who's a very popular local, very popular contemporary theologian. Your heart will always be where your treasure is. And that's Matthew 6:21. The most powerful life is the most simple life. The most powerful life is the life that knows where it's going, that knows where the source of strength is, and the life that stays free of clutter and happenstance and hurriedness. Being busy is not a sin. Jesus was busy. Paul was busy. Peter was busy. Nothing of significance is achieved without effort and hard work and weariness. Being busy in and of itself is not a sin, but being busy in an endless pursuit of things that leave us empty and hollow and broken inside, that cannot be pleasing to God. One source of man's weariness is the pursuit of things that can never satisfy. But which one of us has not been caught up in that pursuit at some time in our life? Our passions, possessions, and pride, these are all dead things. When we try to get life out of dead things, the result is only weariness and dissatisfaction. Saints, as I stood there this morning for about a half an hour or so or more, talking to this owner, John, of the Brown House, he was in shock, holding on to Lucky, his dog Lucky, so happy that he found him. He kept on telling me that there aren't many people in that house now. Most of them have left. And he said, there's really no more people in that house. At that moment, I realized when that crane came to knock the building down, all the hemming and hawing we were talking about as a church and the other bodies of Christ, all the people who've been supplying food for the people who are there right around the corner, for the people who day in and day out see people walking from that house. As a matter of fact, it got to a point where you could have anyone coming from anywhere walking past the parsonage and you assume that they're from the Brown House. That's unfair. But the moment we stood there and the crane knocked the rest of the building down, what became real for me, and I believe for John, was that everything that represented that house, everything that took time to work with and complain about and to try to see if there's ministry involved as far as, you know, food from that the church around the corner, all that's gone. In 20 minutes, what has been a source of different complaints and what has been a source of hopeful ministry for some is gone. God has a tendency to arrange our lives in ways, orchestrate our lives in ways that if we get too busy to concentrate on God, the Lord helps us slow down. The Lord giveth, and the Lord taketh away. Saints, it sends me a message that if we only can focus on what God brings to the table, everything else pales by comparison. So I want to hold up John in prayer and his father in prayer and this elderly gentleman that he saved, even if he had to drag him off the mattress that he was staying in, currently burned. I am thankful I wasn't in that house. And I'm thankful and hoping to God that everyone survived. And just 2 weeks ago at the animal blessing, you stood in your chair and said, "Why don't we bless the people across the street and the dogs?" Remember? And I went across the street, and just at that same time, all the bikers came by, and we blessed the bikers too. And they were going like this, waving back. Saints, when you open your hearts to the Spirit, opportunities arise. Opportunities for other people in touch with God to come up with ideas and blessings and, hey, maybe we could do this to help this or that person. That's how God works through us. In this passage, Jesus says, "Take up your cross and follow me." And everyone has something to complain about. Everyone has a burden on their shoulders. And they ask God, "God, take this off my shoulders." And I used to pray for that. "Take this burden off my shoulders." But you see, what Jesus wants from you, Jesus said, "I've already sacrificed myself on the cross for you. I've sacrificed myself so your sin is covered." That doesn't mean to some, "Well, gee, my sins are covered. I could do whatever I want." We do what we do in practical divinity, John Wesley would say, because of our love of Jesus Christ. So we're not meant to say, "Lord, lift this burden from my shoulders." We're to say, "Lord, help me lift that burden. Help me understand why I have this burden. Help me make it bearable, Lord, but be with me and help me solve this problem. Help me, if it's in your will, to take this burden from me." Because no matter how old you get, you're meant to pass on the fact and internalize the fact that the burdens you take on are yours to bear for extracurricular training, so to speak. If you've been there and done that, Ruth Ann, if you're talking to someone who has no food in the house and is really suffering, that person will, at some point in time, and they always say thank you for what they have, can pass on the love that they've received. That's part of the burden that they're carrying. And through you, the Lord is helping them lift that cross, not removing it, lifting it, so that people know, to the glory of God, that God is present with them and helping them. Every one of you who have experienced the death of a loved one recently know just how stronger the presence of God is in your midst. Let's pray. Oh, Lord, you give each one of us a cross to bear. And, Lord, we really ask, first, before we feel crumbled and have to ask for it totally to be removed, Lord, we ask instead that we build a better relationship with you, that we understand what we're going through, for we know you know what we're going through. Help us, Lord, make that bearable. Help us to learn from it. Help it that it may be able to enable us to do further ministry to ourselves and our family, to this body of Christ and in this community. For Lord, if none of us had struggles, then none of us would be able to talk about the glory of God through the solving of those struggles. We'd never be able to be attuned to the Holy Spirit of someone to whom you could say, listen, I have been there and I've done that. I know what you're talking about. Let's talk about it. Lord, be with those people who were displaced from across the street, that fire. Be with John and his son and the elderly gentleman that was saved from the fire. We hope to God that everyone got out safely. We don't know what to do about this displacement, Lord. We don't know what to do about this situation, but we rest in you, and you let us know what we have the power to do. Just help us stop and pray for these people. Those that are displaced, have them find a home. Those that are elsewhere, may they be thankful for being out alive, and may they, in their own way, Lord, pray for those who are displaced, for this is a problem that persists in so many places. And Lord, thank you for having us be together as a congregation today. Help us find our own strength and in our own ways to hold those who are in prayer in this congregation, to hold them up to the light of Christ. Lord, we ask all this in your holy, precious name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Let us stand and sing hymn number 378, verses 1, 2, and 3, Amazing Grace. Wonderful. Please be seated. One day I would like to be able to see a morning where I say we're going to sing Amazing Grace, and let's say all verses. I just want to see the whites around your eyes, because there's quite a few verses there. Thank you for doing that. And by the way, the choir yesterday was phenomenal. Thank you. And Del, you were part of that process and part of that experience. Thank you so much for lending your gift to us. So we now come to the part of the service where we respond with prayers, praise, and thanksgiving. Now, do we know where the wireless mic is? Oh, okay, so that's the lapel mic. Okay, good. All right, good. people we're raising up in prayer are those people that have been on our hearts that we've been praying for. And there'll come a time I'll ask if you have someone we need to hold up in prayer. And someone will come at the microphone. Because if you speak without the mic, no one can hear you as we live stream. So let's be in prayer. Lord, we ask you to hear those we raise in prayer. Make a way out of no way for them. Debbie and Lou Sharp, Gary and Marilyn Langley, Sylvia Akeley, Leland Frost, Gwen Ellenwood, Ralph Ferguson, Richard and Sally Card, Malcolm Hare, Heidi Hicks Yarborough, Melanie's sister, recently diagnosed with Parkinson's. Everyone in the house across the street, praise be to God. Galen West at 8 Washburn Street is in Cary Hospital with pneumonia and a heart condition. The family of Robert Donovan, Washburn, Maine. Sean Peterson and family. James Stewart, Bruce Fitzpatrick, Audrey Bubar, Ivan Shaw, good to see you this morning, Ivan. Tom Todd, Lou Levitt, who sends his love and smiles. Other than needing a haircut, he looks wonderful. He says, praise God for you and thank you for your prayers. And the McNeil family. Is there any other one we need to pray for today?
The firefighters.
Prayer for the firefighters. Prayers for the people who are in that house and hopefully out of that house now. Prayers for John and his father and that elderly gentleman who were currently there this morning. Lord, we also pray for all those affected by the wildfires that are still raging, the rains and the storms, the natural disasters that happen. We ask that everyone who's displaced by any of that, Lord, that you reach out and somehow connect the resources and the people, not just in prayer, but in those things that are needed monetarily. We pray, Lord, for that powerfully to happen. And Lord, we ask you now to help us pray the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Very good. Thank you. All right. And now we are giving our tithes and offerings. So can the ushers please come forward to accept this morning's offering? Thank you. Oh, Holy Father, bless this offering. Place it in the hands of those who can administer it in this body of Christ to help the people in this community and the people in this body. May we each be an extension of your grace and your love out into the world where we have, Lord, been placed to do the work of God. Lord, help us to serve our lives also as an offering to you for the work of the kingdom. Show us the way with your Holy Spirit we should go. We ask all this in your holy, precious name. Amen. Please be seated. This morning's service of word and table is musical setting B. Yep. And you'll find that on page 18 of your hymnals. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy. When Jesus Christ celebrated the Sabbath with his disciples, this was the night in which you leave one chalice among the place settings and one extra place setting for the prophet Elijah. And you left the door to the outside in the household open in wishing that one day the prophet Elijah would come and grace that household. It's believed that this time Jesus took the bread, broke the bread, and told his disciples that this represents my body, which will be broken for you, for the forgiveness of all sins. So take and eat of this. Do this as often as you remember it. in remembrance of me. Likewise, he took the cup of Elijah that before now has never been raised at a Seder supper. And he said, this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. This represents my blood shed for you. Lord, bless these elements of communion. Bless the body and the blood of Christ. May they be for us the body and the blood of Christ that promises salvation for us. And thank you, Lord, for being present in this sacrament. May we feel your presence entering our body and soul during this sacrament. For it is indeed one of the most personal things that we can do as Christians as we take and partake, rather, of the bread and the fruit of the vine. And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ has died. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Christ will come again.
Lord, we invoked your presence of the Holy Spirit, and we worship the risen Trinity, the Holy Spirit, but God the Father, Christ the Son, and God's Holy Spirit. And Lord, since John Wesley has said that there's no communication with the Holy Spirit that is not a direct conduit to you, God, we ask that you work in each and every one of us assembled here and online to be able to know that they are not only loved, but they are advocates of your Holy Spirit unto the world, empowered by the power of communion and compelled to share the Spirit of Christ with others. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Have the choir and Deb first, please. Thank you for flanking that. Saints, as it is a requirement of the communion elements, we're not to throw anything away. Grape juice goes back to the earth, not down the drain. Bread, especially home-baked bread for the purpose of Holy Communion, needs to be consumed. So we have one half a loaf left. So, the children in this congregation, they love two things: microphones and baked bread. So we're making that available. It'll be brought downstairs for them to split amongst themselves and to eat. And in praise God for that. And in that, that'll be blessed twice. Okay? So we'll bring that down to the fellowship hall. Thank you very much. Our final hymn is hymn 451, Be Thou My Vision. Please stand.
Thank you. yesterday's service, the beloved, the morning service with the beloved member. And first in our God being uncomfortable, unsettled, early in the morning, having to pass 2 days, facing an emergency, and not being able to find what I thought I wanted to find, the information she was wanting, she could do something. And then I had charged up my phone, and I have a digital clock on my phone that comes to the office. And it was fine before noon, and now it's all out of power. Saying you can find God. Anything you want to find God. But I take that to mean this. It's not important that the clock showed you the time. I know at the end of our service. It's not important